Hi, I'm Janice Lee. I'm the clinical director for the NIDCR, and I'm the chief of the craniofacial anomalies regeneration section. Cleft lip and palate is the most common craniofacial anomaly, and typically we can identify this while the baby is growing in utero or identified shortly after birth. And this is a condition in which instead of a continuous lip, there is a notch or there's a full defect that extends up into the nose. And so the lip is in two segments. And you can imagine this affects the way a child can feed. And it certainly is a condition that affects the entire family because oftentimes birth defects are conditions that require treatment by a comprehensive craniofacial anomalies team. I think in terms of the most advancement that we've seen in craniofacial anomalies, it's been in the cleft lip and palate arena again. And that's because craniofacial anomalies teams have come together. This has been something that really has emphasized the patient in the center of treatment, but also the need for comprehensive care. Comprehensive care includes specialists from across different backgrounds. And that includes the dentist, the surgeon, orthodontists, speech pathologists, geneticists, genetic counselors, pediatricians, and nurses. And together, we're able to provide these patients who are born with cleft lip and palate a full comprehensive palate of care. And when we're able to do that, we know that the outcome appears to be much better. And this is something that is well established in the US. And it also has affected the way we sequence these treatments. So craniofacial anomalies teams will care for these cleft lip and palate patients all the way from birth to adulthood. And each of these teams are able to provide, again, treatment recommendations and also follow the development of these patients throughout their entire lifespan. And this is really important because at each step of a child's development with one of these congenital anomalies, there's always different concerns and families always have the guidance of these craniofacial teams when they're plugged in. So some of the areas that really can change the way we care for these patients with congenital anomalies, craniofacial anomalies in particular, is the ability to predict and to understand who's at the greatest risk. Because if we can understand who's at greatest risk or which families are at risk, we can do things that could potentially prevent these conditions from occurring. That includes targeted therapy. We're far from that at this point. However, if we're able to predict who has a craniofacial anomaly at birth, we would be able to prepare. We could also prevent. And our therapies obviously would be there to work with the families in preparation for correcting these craniofacial anomalies. But prediction as well as early treatment is really something that we're all working towards in terms of craniofacial anomalies. When I see these families and the patients, one of the most important things really is to talk about their expectations and to be sure that I can answer the questions with them. Typically, this requires that I involve a number of specialists as well. Because one of the most important things is to communicate with the families and to really help them prepare for treatment. And oftentimes the treatment is surgery. And so being available to support our families and the patient, being available to answer questions and giving them the support they need is really important. I also want to make sure that the families, especially early on, recognize that this isn't something that they could have prevented. Oftentimes the family and the patients have some guilt and they wonder what could they have done differently. And oftentimes we've got to spend some time speaking about the fact that we don't know what the causes are. And we certainly don't think anything that the mom, the dad, or the patient did contributed to the congenital anomaly. So this is a really important time where we provide support for these families. And again, if necessary, we'll provide counseling, but it's so important to understand the patient's expectations, the family's expectations, and really understand what we can provide to the family in terms of support. Being a mom has changed my perspective quite a bit. You start to realize that these young people, even at a very, very young age, they have an opinion and they want to be heard. And I love the fact that kids, even at very young ages, can be so engaging and so communicative. I think that's been one of the big things that has changed now that I have my own child. But even before being a mother, one of the most important things that impressed upon me when I was meeting with these families is that these families are trusting me as a care provider, as a surgeon, and giving me full trust and confidence to do the right thing for their child. And that is huge. And that has always impacted the way I handle these situations and I handle and manage and support these families because it's a big, big responsibility. And when you appreciate that responsibility, you do everything possible to make sure these families get the best they can, because it's something that I would want for myself. And so that philosophy has always been with me, even before my son was born. But having a kid of my own, it really brings about my appreciation for respecting a child and their families in terms of the dynamic. It's a huge process in terms of teasing out what everybody wants. And during these very intimate discussions with the child and the family, you really become very much a part of their family because they're sharing things with you. And sometimes you find things out, and sometimes the family finds things out right there at these visits. If you can think back just a couple of decades ago, we were still doing ultrasound. And ultrasound or sonography, where pregnant moms come and have their bellies checked with an ultrasound machine, it was all two dimensional. Now we can start to see things in 3D. And especially for the craniofacial region, that's tremendous. That technology has really allowed us to see things and to appreciate growth and development in utero. When we have 3D imaging, there are a couple of things that I do. I use the 3D images, first of all, to show the families. And for example, a dental facial deformity where the facial proportions are not quite within normal range. And because of that, these patients require surgery. When you show them something in 3D, especially the skeleton, the reaction and the response by the patient and their family is first, wow, their minds are blown away just because of the coolness of seeing their skeleton in 3D. But then what we do today that I've never done before is I'll invite the patient, the family, and the referring specialist to our virtual surgical planning sessions. And when we do that, again, it gives them just a sense of understanding what they're going to be going through in terms of surgery. And when they start to see that, they have different questions, they're excited. And when I know that their fears and their anxiety are starting to come down because they're starting to understand the procedure, and many, many of the families and patients are really appreciative of this opportunity to actually see us planning the surgery in 3D virtually, this is really exciting for them. And surgery is never something people look forward to, but when I see them participate in their care, when I see them asking questions and feeling like they're a part of the surgical team, it's really, really rewarding. And I think that has been a huge game changer for me, the ability to show my patients what the surgery looks like on a 3D skeleton. That's tremendous.